When this music is played in the right spirit, I know the effect that it can have. I know how special it is, and I know how it impacts people.
When I interviewed Mulgrew Miller in 2008, we talked about his music, and we talked about how he feels when he plays jazz and its effect on the audience. And of course, given the way Mulgrew played and the people he played with, a lot of people were affected by his music. And thankfully, although he left us much, much too soon, that music is still with us. I shot some video documenting Mulgrew. He has many excellent recordings. And I feel he's the best pianist of my generation. He plays with the kind of majesty and spirit that also emboldens the music of McCoy Tyner. Shortly after he left us, I put together a short doc which includes his music and excerpts from the interview that I did with him. Mulgrew was a wonderful man. I miss him tremendously. It was great to hang out with him. It was great to go to hear him play. I heard him many times in many different groups, both on his own, with Tony Williams, with Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. Superb musician.
I know how special this music is because through the grace of God, I've been allowed to walk among the giants, be on the bandstand with them. When this music is played in the right spirit, I know the effect that it can have. I know how special it is, and I know how it impacts people. I think that's important. This is one of the few things that you can do in society and, you know, express yourself freely and creatively. You know, this is one of the most creative things you can do.
I'm gonna play a Cole Porter song called I Love You.
This music affords us an experience that I think many other people don't get in other areas of functioning in life. Playing this music sort of compels us to be in the moment. We're not always there, most of us. When we are in the bandstand and that something happens, when we know we have performed in a way that we don't usually perform, that happens on occasion. Where we realized we weren't even there. It wasn't really about us. You know, we were being a channel for creativity to express itself. And that's such a profound experience, you know, that when it happens, we're driven to try to find that experience again. And I dare say that that's what keeps us coming to the bandstand every night. Many of the musicians I've played with over the years, many of them have left the planet. Guys like Woody Shaw, Art Blakey, Johnny Griffin, and Tony Williams, who died for this music, put an investment in me. They invested their time and their interest and their love in me. I feel like that I have a charge to keep, to carry that message on. And that's why being a jazz messenger has that title has a special significance to me at this time. I grew up in a segregated society. I saw all the marches and demonstrations, and I remember the for colored signs and all of that kind of stuff. I remember very vividly the civil rights movement and the freedom riders and all of that that came through Mississippi. I was in the first wave of children that integrated the schools in Mississippi. I didn't go to school with white kids until I was 10th grade. What's interesting about that period is that our parents, who lived under those kind of conditions, never taught us to hate. In some remarkable ways, protected us emotionally and physically from the damage that could occur. We were taught, stay in your place. That was for your protection. Don't be on the wrong side of town, and you know, this and that. Don't be anywhere that you're not supposed to be. Get your education. I think at the time, many of our parents and grandparents were really not that hopeful about integration. I don't think they saw the possibility of it coming in their lifetime, although it did happen. But they were hopeful about you getting an education and succeeding in life. That was important to them. It was important that a young child would grow up and cultivate some kind of integrity. That whole King movement, Martin Luther King, and you know, that was the focus. You grow up and maintain some kind of integrity about yourself as a black man or black woman. I think I still carry those values. I remember discussing this with Steve Nelson a couple of years ago when I first got this appointment. And I said, well, Steve, you know, I didn't think I would be at this point in my life. I would be doing this at this point in my life. I thought maybe later on. He said, Miller, he always calls me Miller, you know, as long as we've known each other, he's called me Miller. He said, well, Miller, you're 50 years old. It's already later on.
You can play Tenor Madness on your solo.
Make sure you play
it. One, two.
I think it's essential that people who have had the opportunity to walk with the giants, so to speak, as I've had the opportunity to do, it's important that we continue the legacy of this music and that we share with these young people coming up, share with them our knowledge and our experience, because there aren't many Art Blakeys around. There are not enough band leaders around for them to play with. One thing that many of them are doing is going to school and studying in the colleges and universities. It's imperative that musicians such as myself and others, you know, Bobby Watson and Terrell Stafford and so many others, Antonio Hart, you know, that we go into schools and talk about what we've learned from all of these people. It's always been said that jazz can't be taught, and I think that's very true. You can point the way and you can guide, you know. I always feel like if I can get the students to learn how to listen, and then they can teach themselves. The main thing for me is to, as an educator, to give them ears, so to speak, so that they learn to listen. And if they learn to listen in the right way, they can go on and teach themselves. And that's what you have to do ultimately anyway, is teach yourself. I tell you one thing about young kids, their minds are fresh and they're not quite habit bound yet. It's interesting to see their viewpoint on the same issues, so to speak, to see how they come to the music and their perspective on improvising and all of that, because, you know, they're bright and they're intelligent and they are creative. I'm stimulated and inspired by just watching them. We can really prepare the students to go out and be somewhat ready to perform. Of course, the learning process goes on forever, you know. We just kind of to try to give them a foundation. You never quite get to the point where you don't see where you can grow further or develop further. And that's been an incredible thing, because when I've talked to the people I admire, you know, they're always talking about continuous growth and development. When I look at them and say, you know, well, what are you going to do, you know? But as Harold Mayburn says, you know, there's always Art Tatum records around. So, you know, for any pianist to get complacent, they're examples, such as the recordings of Bud, Oscar Peterson, or whatever, all of the masters, to show you that there are other levels of attainment, you know. And if I should ever approach the level of Art Tatum, I'm putting out notice.